Dear colleagues, dear friends, it's a great honor for me as a rector of Charles University in Prague to welcome you in our aula of Faculty of Law of our university. You should ask why we are on the Faculty of Law, why not in the Carolinum or in the other places in 160 buildings which owned by the Charles University. But there is a very nice place in the center and with huge number of seats for the interesting speech of Professor Hoyer. Our university is tightly connected with the CERN as institution, where one member state of the CERN is the Czech Republic. And we are very grateful that our Faculty of Mathematics and Physics is one of the part of CERN which makes some scientific influence of research in the physics and in the development in this area. It's a great honor for me to cordially welcome Professor Hoyer, Director General of CERN, which will coming to celebrate together with us 60 years anniversary of foundation of CERN. Professor Hoyer, that's not the first time in Prague, but during this visit you have a very, very tough program, which visiting the faculty, university, the Czech Technical University, Academy of Sciences, and also the Charles University. And Professor Hoyer is not only as a manager, but it's a well-known and world-respected scientist in this field, which work in CERN connected more than 30 years. And on this occasion, we also awarded Professor Hoyer by the Gold Medal of the Charles University for excellent cooperation in the past, but we are not much looking to the past, but we must looking to the future. And I would like to ask Professor Hoyer to put a lecture about the 60 years of CERN for the peace with these particles, and I mean that in this lecture we also mentioned what in the next 60 years or in the next future of the CERN will be prepared and participated all member state and institution which are in CERN. Professor Hoyer, thank you for coming to Prague, and floor is yours.
Thank you very much. So if you don't mind, I cannot give a talk without moving. So I stay here because it's too dangerous behind that part here. Okay, I might disappear. Okay, 60 years of CERN means also 60 years of science for peace. And at the beginning of the talk, I try to introduce a little bit why it is really 60 years of science for peace. So I cover a little bit some of the aspects outside research of CERN, but then, of course, I will also concentrate mainly on the research. So, CERN was founded in 1954 by 12 European states. Today, we have 21 member states. And in order to appreciate the slogan Science for Peace, you have to go back into the end of the 40s, 49. Europe was in ruins, and there was no science possible, especially no big science. So it needed a few visionary scientists and a few visionary diplomats to resonate, to get together, and to propose a laboratory which goes beyond the means of an individual country. Because if you want to do big science, if you want to do science at the forefront of nuclear, at that time of nuclear physics, you have to unite forces. And that was the founding of CERN, which came to fruition in 1954. Is the sound okay? I have some echo on. Is it okay? Okay, so that then gave birth to CERN in 1954. And today we have 21 member states. And when you look onto the member states, as well as the applicant states for membership or associate membership, and if you look in the world around us, where we have problems where we have countries which are not so much on ease with each other. You see, you have here Israel, you have Turkey, you have Ukraine, you have Russia, you have Pakistan, you have Cyprus. It's interesting. They can talk to each other. They can work with each other if they want to. And I think CERN is a fantastic place in order to do that. And this is why I think science research can help to illustrate that you can do things together once you really have the will to do it. Okay, so another aspect is that in 2010, we have made a big step forward, to my mind, in the history of CERN. We have redefined the E in CERN from Europe to everywhere. So that means any country, independent of the geographical location, can become a member of CERN. And you see the first country which is a full member of CERN outside the official definition of Europe is Israel. And then you see, Pakistan and Brazil will follow as associate members. So we are really becoming a global lab. We have roughly 4,000 people on our payroll. The 1,600 other paid personnel out of these are, to a large extent, young people in for 2 years positions, fellowships, or young engineers in order to get experience at CERN after they graduate or after they get their PhD. And we have around between 10 and 11,000 scientific users who are coming to CERN in order to do their science. And for those who are not so familiar with CERN, this is the reason why CERN was founded. That's the mission of CERN. Research without any military application. That's very important. That's written in the convention. But you cannot do forefront research without forefront innovations. You cannot buy the technologies off shelf. You have to develop them. And there are quite a few people from the CAS, from the Accelerator School, which is presently happening here in Prague. Who is from the CAS? Oh my goodness, I'm talking to the converted. Okay, very good. So they were so kind to come here to listen to this lecture. We have to have really a lot of innovations and technologies, and in particular, of course, also in the accelerator sector. Research and innovation are fantastic means in order to do education, to do training, and the CAS, the Accelerator School, is for education and training, as one example. And CERN is a unique example. Uniting people. You cannot do it alone. You need other people to help you. So, in the research, we want to push back the frontiers of knowledge. We would like to understand how the universe developed, how everything began. Not why, but how. And what was the universe's first moment's existence? In order to do this, I already told you, we have to develop new technologies for accelerators, detectors, but also for information technology. And we should not forget that we are not only celebrating 60 years of CERN, but also 25 years of the World Wide Web. The World Wide Web was born at CERN 25 years ago. Many people don't know that. But everybody, I think, appreciates that we did it. Okay. Science, technologies, it's a fantastic training ground for scientists and engineers. As in particular engineering. CERN is an engineering lab. We need engineers. We have a lot of engineers on our payroll. We need engineers of tomorrow. And again, uniting people from different countries and different cultures. This was a view from 1954. Those who were already at CERN might recognize this is the Rue de Merin, because here's a church. This was the first accelerator at CERN, the synchrocyclotron. In the mid-50s, the first accelerator arrives. At that time, the accelerator was still put on a trailer of a tractor. I like the accompanying people here on their motorbikes and with their cylinders. It is slightly different today. But that was the start of CERN with the synchrocyclotron. Today, that's our accelerator complex. You are not seeing the synchrocyclotron anymore because this is now a museum, which is actually, by the way, very nice very nice to visit. It has been followed by Isolde, but what you see here is roughly 45 to 50 kilometers of tunnel of accelerators, which are now at CERN, at the CERN premises. And all these smaller accelerators, they all house different experiments. And of course, everything culminates at the end, at the moment, in with the LHC, with the highest energy frontier machine ever built by mankind. So you can do a lot of different physics here, and this is the particle physics landscape at CERN. You see, we have, of course, the high energy frontier, LHC, but we have also hadronic matter, low energy experiments, few non-accelerator experiments, but also some multidisciplinary one, climate research, for example, what is the influence of cosmic rays on the cloud formation and on medical application. So the non-LHC physics is around 10% of our users compared to the LHC. So it's very important for a laboratory like CERN to have a beacon, to have a flagship like the LHC, but it's also extremely important to have scientific diversity at unique facilities, facilities which you have nowhere else in the world, like the antiproton decelerator, where we can study the behavior of antimatter, for example. And what we are doing at present, we are maintaining and upgrading all these unique facilities. So we are supporting all this diversity program over the next years. And researchers from Prague, from the different universities and from the academy participate in several activities within these different areas. So, energy frontier, but also in the other experiments. So they use very nicely CERN. And I want to remind you, CERN is an intergovernmental organization. It's a European, normally, a priori, a European intergovernmental organization. That means it's a treaty organization. All the treaties of the member states with CERN have to be ratified in the parliaments. But it's a European organization globally used. It's an infrastructure which is belonging to all its member states. For example, to the Czech Republic. You are a stakeholder here in the Czech Republic, and you are using this facility. It's your facility. And I think it's one of the best examples of what Europe, and of course its partners all over the world, can achieve when they are working together. This is a prime example. And you see 1954, the first session of CERN Council. We celebrate this on the 19th of September with a memorial session of our present council. 1980, the East meets the West, delegation of Beijing at CERN. And I know that during the time of the Iron Curtain, our researcher colleagues from the East were so happy to come to the West, but they could only come to CERN. So CERN was uniting people here again. And today it's a global collaboration. The LHC brings together more than 8,000 scientists and it's some 100 nationalities. So it's a key message here. From the very beginning, it was peaceful cooperation at the forefront of science and independent of cultural and national differences. Very, very important at that time as well as today. So we are breaking the walls, so to speak, between cultures and nations since 1954, and that gives you the distribution of all the CERN users by nationality. That was a survey in January 2014. And you see, if you have good eyes, you can identify the Czech Republic with more than 200 researchers coming to CERN to do the research. So that is much more than you would expect from the contribution of the Czech Republic, and I'm happy that the Czech Republic is using CERN so strongly. But you see, we have also between 30% and 40% of scientific users coming from all around the world. This is a very nice distribution. This is the age distribution of the visiting scientists at CERN. And you see, it peaks at 26. Of course, it's mainly PhD students, and I think if I would do, this is a few years old, of course, all these guys are now older. But if you would repeat the same survey, it would peak even more at 26, because we have between 2,500 and 3,000 PhD students performing their PhD thesis at the LHC experiments. So this is a very healthy distribution also. If you have good eyes, you see it's 85. This person is now a bit older, but still active. Huh? It's fantastic. It's great. Now, in order to get young people to keep such a field young, you need students. In order to get students, you need good teachers. Good teachers are key to educate the young people. And we have a teacher's program, courses of 1 week, typically 1 week duration in the mother language of the teachers. So they can come, get these courses, have some hands-on experiments, and then go back, and they are multiplicators with their in their schools, and they come back with their pupils. And you see here, since a few years, we are reaching roughly 1,000 teachers per year which go through this teacher program. Meanwhile, we had teachers from 74 countries, and you can see there are quite a few teachers from different countries here in the English language course. There's one who is not a teacher, definitely not. He's only there in order to, yeah, I don't know. Okay, today, as I said, we have roughly 1,000 teachers per year, and I was just at the exhibition in the academy, and I saw a lot of school classes there. It was really full. I was twice there. It was full each time with pupils, and some of them were coming with their teachers who had passed through this teachers program. So this is absolutely vital to have good and motivated teachers. And that shows you where the teachers are coming, they're coming from in the past years, from essentially all over the world. The Czech Republic here is with 146 on here. It's good for the size of the Czech Republic, but it's an, again, it's a very important program for everybody all over the year, all over the world. And more countries want to connect with CERN in order to plug in to this program. As a matter of fact, then of course these teachers come back with their school classes to visit, and you see the CERN guided tours, the participants in half-day tours, how this has was shooting up since 2009. Today, last year we had nearly 100,000 participants in these guided tours with over 200,000 requests, and around 40% are school classes. Again, very important to entice the young people. And that, since I was just with the Hungarian teachers 1.5 weeks ago, this is the impact of the Hungarian teachers program on the visits to CERN, and you see how this is shooting up. I cannot extrapolate it linearly, but it is great to see that these teachers are all coming back with their school classes. This brings the people into science. Some afterwards they go somewhere else, but they study science first. Okay, in addition, we have some things like Beamline for Schools, a school lab. So we try to do a lot for students and even for kids of age 7 to 9. Now this, of course, I have put in because of the cast of the accelerator school. That was a joke. We do research in and with accelerator technology, and we use accelerator technology. And I think today we have around 30,000 accelerators all around the world in use. And you see research is a small part of it. Most of it is either in industry or in medical applications. And medical applications is a very nice example. In the proton therapy, for example, you have one here, a private one in Prague, what I just learned, which is already treating patients. But CERN was in very strongly involved in collaboration in design and development of new proton therapy centers, like now in Italy and MedAustron in Austria. But if you look now on the timeline between the basic science with which everything starts and the technological development, you see the cyclotron, which is used today for the tumor therapy, was in the early 20s or late 20s. The first proton irradiation in Berkeley in the 50s, the first hospital with proton treatment in the 80s, and today we have nearly 40 therapy centers all over the world. So it took 60 years from the basic science part into the application. So this is, of course, a long time for politicians. But there's another aspect, the medical diagnostics with antimatter. The first example was just from the instruments, from the technologies which we needed to develop in order to do our science. Medical diagnostic with antimatter means seeing better and more with less radiation dose, the positron emission tomography. And of course, everybody of you know that the P, the positron, is the antiparticle to the electron. So we are using antimatter in the hospital since roughly 40 years. You see, basic research was more than 80 years ago, prediction and discovery of antimatter. At that time, it took 3 years between the postulation and the discovery of antimatter. for the Higgs, it took a bit longer, I will tell you. But it took 45 years then to use antimatter the first time with positron emission tomography in 1977 in a collaboration between the hospital in Geneva and CERN. And today, the new generation of PET are crystals which are developed, have been developed for LHC detectors, and they are now used in these PET scans. So again, it takes a long time from the research to the application. Okay, that brings me now to research. Of course, our scientific challenge is to understand the first moments of the universe, yeah, from the Big Bang, when everything was tremendously small, tremendously hot, tremendously high energy, evolving over nearly 14 billion years, cooling down to 2.7 Kelvin, 2.7 degrees above absolute zero, and expanding from this tiny hotspot into a size of 10 to the 28 centimeters. Now, it's difficult to imagine these scales. I put it here on a ruler. The universe today, 10 to the 28 centimeters. The universe at the Big Bang, close to zero, let's say 10 to the minus 32 centimeters. Very difficult to imagine these small numbers. Very difficult to imagine the large numbers. Maybe I can try to help you. 10 to the 28 centimeters. If you replace the centimeter by dollars, you have roughly the square of the American deficit. I don't know if that helped you a lot, but at least it tells me that the deficit is relatively high. Okay, so what can you do in order to investigate the history of the universe? Well, you can go into the large scale. You can look into the history by ground-based telescopes, you can use space-based telescopes, and the more powerful your telescope, the higher resolution your telescope, the more detail you find of the early universe development, the closer you come to the Big Bang. There is a problem, however. If you use photons, then you hit the wall of 380,000 years, because up to 380,000 years, the universe was still so hot that no atoms could form. No atoms could form because they were always ionized again. So no photons could get out, no information, except maybe on some polarization effects, which we have still to see if that can be verified. But in principle, you cannot get any information earlier than 380,000 years. What to do? Well, 380,000 years is already a good success. That's pretty close already. So what could you do? Well, you go to the small scale. And the big difference here is, at the large scale, you look into the history of the universe. At the small scale, you reproduce the condition at that moment. So that's a huge difference. Yeah? You are not looking into the history, you are reproducing the conditions, and that you do with a supermicroscope. And the LHC is able to resolve sizes down to 10 to the minus 16, 10 to the minus 17 centimeters. So much, much smaller than a proton diameter. Now, most of you know the role of accelerators because you're in that school. The high energy, that means you can resolve the inner structure of matter in a better way. Higher energy means smaller wavelengths, that means resolving smaller dimensions. At the same time, higher energy gives you higher mass particles, so you can produce new particles with higher masses, so you can find new particles. And the big advantage of accelerators is that you can repeat the experiment very often, so you get high statistics, precision experiments. So high energy, high resolving power, high statistics. So, with the LHC, we are getting closest to the Big Bang compared to everybody else, less than 10 to the minus 12 seconds. So for those who don't know these numbers, it's a millionth of a second. So I call it breaking the wall of the hidden universe. Nobody else gets closer. And that's the fascination of this type of science. And what have we learned? Well, since more than 100 years, we know that the atomos are no atomos. You can divide them into the nuclei and the electron. The nuclei, in turn, consist out of the protons and the neutrons, which, in turn, consist out of the quarks and, of course, the force particles, the gluons. Now, what have we learned there? That's our standard model of particle physics. That's two quarks, two leptons, and we have three families of two quarks, two leptons each. And the only difference between the families is that in the horizontal line, these ones are heavier than these ones. So this one, the top quark, is the heaviest elementary particle we know up to now in the world. It is as heavy as a gold atom, but it's a point-like particle. Again, very difficult to imagine a point-like particle as heavy as a gold atom. And we still don't understand why nature has introduced such huge mass differences between the different families. Now, one disappointment now for you is most probably that if you look onto these particles, we need only three particles, the up quark, the down quark, and the electron, in order to form all of you. You all consist only out of three metaparticles, well, me too. Namely, the up and the down quark, which form neutrons and protons, and the electron, which forms then finally the atom. So, this is all we need for the visible world. But nature has introduced more particles, and we still have to understand why only three, why three families that we know that we need at least three, but why are there not more? Now, these particles, of course, these fundamental particles, they have to interact with each other. They have to talk to each other. And they talk through the force particles. The photon is talking about the is transmitting the electromagnetic force. The gluons are transporting the strong force, which keeps the nuclei together, for example. And the Z and W bosons, they are responsible for the exchange of the weak force, which is, for example, responsible for some of the processes in the sun. So that's fantastic. Yeah? Is there a chemist in the room? Nobody wants to, so then it's no use to tell you that I think particle physics is much easier than chemistry, because the periodic system is much easier than the periodic system of chemistry. So this is why I became a particle physicist. Now this is a fantastic model here. And this standard model was tested over decades, essentially five decades, with very high precision. However, before the LHC was turned on, there was one crucial question left open. How do elementary particles acquire mass? Now you might ask, why is this important? I think it's very important for you, because if the particles would all be massless, it would be extremely difficult, if not excluded, to form composite matter. That means we could, in principle, then not exist. So for us, it's of vital importance that most of these particles are massive, that they have mass. So how can you establish the theory which could give elementary particles a mass? Well, you do that with a solution of inertia. You can define the mass also as a property of particles with some energy E to move with the velocity V, which is normalized to the velocity of light, and that's the formula. And you see, if the particle is massless, it always moves with the velocity of light. The more massive the particle at a constant energy, the smaller the velocity of the particle. The higher the mass, the lower the velocity. So what do? You introduce a scalar field, that means a field without omnipresent but without any preferred direction. And that was introduced by these six theorists, Prout, Ongler, Higgs, Kippel, Gorelnik, and Hagen. And the particles acquire mass through interaction with this field. You can imagine a particle which does not talk to this field is massless. A particle which talks a little bit with this field has a small mass. A particle which talks tremendously with the field is very heavy. We would not know anything about the existence of this field if it would not have a speciality, namely it talks to itself. It talks to itself, that means that's the Higgs boson. So the self-interaction of the field is the Higgs particle. How am I doing with time? Still going, okay, yeah, okay. So how can you imagine that now? Oops, that was... So now the question is, has the LHC now answered the crucial question how do elementary particles acquire mass, but there are, I think, some transparencies missing, if I'm not mistaken, I'm a bit surprised. Okay, but this is then the standard model Higgs, which would be in the center of everything here because it would be responsible to give mass to the elementary particles. Yes, my nice example is missing. Okay, don't worry, don't worry. So the example is the following. Imagine you have a huge room full of journalists. It's a cocktail party of the journalists, and they are equally distributed everywhere in the room. That's a scalar field, there's no preferred direction. And that means they are just waiting for something. And then I open the door here, and I want to go through the room and out here. Nobody knows me, nobody talks to me. I have the velocity of the light, so I'm massless, okay? Then we open the door here, and somebody comes in whom they know. For example, at that time, Albert Einstein. Immediately, the journalists cluster around the person because they want to interview him. And then he slowly continues, and the more known the person, the more they talk to him, that means the heavier the person. Okay? So that's the way you acquire mass in the interaction with the journalists. How can you imagine the Higgs boson itself? Well, again, I open the door and I whisper a rumor into the room. And then the journalists cluster. What did he say? But there's nothing. There's only the rumor and the journalists. And this cluster of the journalists is the Higgs boson. And it decays again and forms again. Yeah, so it's a very good example. And this I had as an illustration, but this should show you that it's, doesn't matter, come on. Doesn't. So, but the standard model tested very well, nonetheless leaves many other key questions open, like where is the antimatter? Again, it's a crucial question for everybody. Because matter and antimatter are produced with the same amount in the same quantity. And once they meet, they annihilate. So again, we should not exist. However, nature has introduced small differences in the properties of matter and antimatter. That leaves now one part in 10 billion more matter than antimatter. And this one part in 10 billion is sitting here. Well, some of it at least. And keep in mind always, we are a small distortion of the universe, by the way, okay? So, but we haven't solved this question, where is the antimatter? Why did not everything annihilate? And in particular, we have this question that the standard model only describes merely 5% of the universe, the visible universe. 95% are dark. A quarter of it, roughly, is dark matter, which clumps like normal matter. 3/4 is a dark energy which drives the universe accelerated apart. We have no clue what dark matter is. We know even less about dark energy. So at least the DG's dream is that with a Large Hadron Collider we might now enter the dark universe. And I put explicitly also a question mark on it because it's a hope, it's a dream, but sometimes dreams become reality. So, the Large Hadron Collider, no, I'm sorry for the accelerator school guys, largest scientific instrument ever built, 27 kilometers circumference, met much, much more than 10,000 people involved in design, construction, and exploitation. It collides protons to reproduce the conditions of the early universe, and it does it 40 million times a second. And this is the LHC, how the Director General likes to see it. It's closed, nobody in the tunnel. We can do the experiments, we can run the collider. And I hope it will soon be again like this, namely at the end of the year. It's one of the coldest places in the universe because it has a temperature of -271 Celsius or 1.9 degrees above absolute zero. It's colder than outer space because we run the magnets at superfluid temperature of superfluid helium, otherwise we could not construct such an accelerator. at the same time, it's one of the hottest places in the galaxy. Because these collisions of the proton beams generate temperatures which are hugely beyond the temperatures in the sun, but in a tiny, tiny spot. That's the point. If you collide one proton with the other proton, it's like colliding a mosquito with another mosquito in full fly. Colliding two mosquitoes in full fly, I don't think you reach anything like the early universe. But if you divide that energy by the area of the proton, which is very, very small, you get a huge energy density. And it's this energy density which brings you to these reactions, processes of the early universe. So that is the main emphasis here. And again, for those who don't know the collider very well, we have in the magnets two vacuum pipes where we have 2,800 packets running clockwise, 2,800 running anticlockwise, and in each packet we have more than 100 billion protons. And this we have in 2,800 packets each. And then we bring these packets to collision. Now if we collide these packets, nothing happens, because the protons are so small that the probability that two protons hit each other is very, very tiny. So what we have to do is we have to focus these beams very much. And the more we focus them, the more collisions of protons we get. And typically we have several tens of protons which collide. That means the constituents of the protons collide. So we have interacting quarks and interacting gluons. These constituents interact at very high energy density. And out of this very high energy densities, other particles are produced, and we have to measure these particles. We have to measure their distribution, their energy, etc. In order to do this, we construct very large, powerful detectors, like digital cameras with 100 million sensors each around these collision points, to detect, to record these pictures, these images, and then to interpret these images afterwards. And this is now some sportive action. Which one is it? This one? Okay, I just started. I could have saved my energy. So this shows you how it works. The particles are inside the magnets. They are running around. Switzerland is in Schengen, so that is no problem. And then you see the constituents here in a proton. They come from one side and from the other side. The packets get squeezed, and then when you are lucky, the protons are hitting each other. And here they do, and out of this, new particles are coming out. And then we register the traces of these particles and have to interpret them. And now this is a special event. Forget the white traces, the white particles. Only look at the two blue ones here and the two blue ones there. They penetrate the detector much further than all the other ones. So they are particles which also are particles of the cosmic rays, that is the muons. They penetrate the detector much more than the other particles. So we have four of these blue tracks, four muons. That is important in a few transparencies. So 2010, we started a new era in fundamental science when we switched on the LHC at a new energy frontier which has never been obtained by mankind before. Four big experiments: ATLAS CMS, LHCb ALICE, and three small ones, TOTEM, LHCf, and MÖDAL. And Prague is involved in ATLAS, in ALICE, and in TOTEM and MÖDAL, and I think I have all the Prague institutes here covered. This is ATLAS during the construction. Now, of course, it's all filled with sensors, as I said, around 100 million sensors. And you see the size of this experiment is huge. Many of you might have seen it already. That's the size of an average physicist. Okay, got it? So it's 25 times 25 times 45 cubic meters. The other experiment, CMS, is a compact experiment. It's only 15 times 15 times 25 cubic meters. And both experiments, CMS as well as Atlas, they comprise around 3,000 members from around 40 countries. If you have 3,000 members, maybe you have 200, 300 professors with their groups. That means 200, 300 egos. 200, 300 egos to bring them together, to work in the same direction. It works. It's fantastic. It's fantastic. They know they cannot do it alone. They need the others. And when you know you need the others, then you know that the others need you. So you have to give and you can take. That's collaboration. It works very well. Now, the study of the LHC data will hopefully help us to answer some of these key questions. What was matter after the Big Bang, before protons and neutrons were formed? Have we found the Higgs particle now, really, which is, in quotes, responsible for giving mass to all particles? Will we still find the reason why antimatter and matter did not completely destroy each other? And this tiny question, this stupid question, what is 96% of the universe made of? Yeah? It's a small question. It's a great question. It's a fantastic question. I will now concentrate just on the Higgs particle. Now, there's a problem. If you search for the Higgs boson at the LHC, you have here, I think, 10 or 12 orders of magnitude difference in the production, in the total production rate of any of the processes which can happen as a function of the energy of the collider. And down here, you have the production probability for a Higgs boson. So there's less than one Higgs boson produced per tens of billions of events. It's only produced, then you have to identify it. But already to produce it, you'd need tens of billions of events. This is why we need such a huge statistics. And this is why we have the grid, the computing technologies. The experiments are producing per year more than 25 petabytes of data. I don't know if that tells you anything, but if you look on this insert, 25 petabytes correspond to 25,000 terabyte. That's trivial. But 25,000 terabyte is 25,000 times the world annual book production. It's a huge amount of data which you have to store, to calibrate, and to analyze. And this is why we are connected to around 160 computing centers all around the world. So that's the fifth global collaboration at LHC. And CERN is a driving force in grid computing, and this is a driving force in cloud computing. Okay. So back to this, we have now stored all this data, now we can analyze them, and there comes the next problem, that the Higgs has many different decay possibilities. It has to talk to every other particle, so it can decay, can be produced and decay in all other types of particles. So this is the probability to decay in some of these particles as a function of the Higgs boson mass, hypothetical Higgs boson mass. And you see, there is at every mass possibility, you have a tremendous amount of different channels into which the Higgs can decay, different images, and that, of course, produces a problem in the analysis. You have a small statistics here, which gets even smaller when you break it up into the different possibilities. One of the most cleanest one is that is the decay into two sets, which decay afterwards into two leptons each. That makes four leptons, for example, four muons. And these were the 2 × 2 blue tracks, which you saw in the video. The other very clean signature is the decay into two photons. Now, and this is a striking signature of a possible Higgs boson decay. The Higgs here decaying into one photon and the other one. The other tracks are not interesting in this event. You see there is no charge track in front of this energy deposition. The larger this arrow, the more energy is in this collision, is in this photon. You combine these two photons to an invariant mass, and of course you can produce two photons also in other standard model processes. But if you have it in other standard model processes, you have a continuous line if you plot this invariant mass. So here's the invariant mass of the two photons, and this is the normal background from standard model processes. And if you have a resonance, a peak, or a small mountain on it like this, then you have something new. And this was the signature of the discovery of the Higgs boson on the July 4, 2012. So this was the first clear indication that we have the Higgs boson. How many? I have now still 10 minutes, Ivan? Yes? So I can guide you through a very complicated transparency. This one. Well, it starts easy. That's the development of the signal strengths over 12 months. You know, in particle physics, a discovery is not coming from today to tomorrow. It takes time. It comes. And if you are unlucky and it's only a fluctuation, it goes again. We have lived through many fluctuations. So, what was happening? So, this was July 2011, a year before the discovery. What is plotted here is a hypothetical mass of the Higgs boson, and here is essentially the probability that what you observe is not a fluctuation. So that is a fluctuation, sorry, I always get it wrong. It is a fluctuation, yes. No, that is not. No, it's a probability that it is a fluctuation. Because these guys plotted the other way around, yeah, as you normally would think. So, July 2011, there were quite a few fluctuations, going nearly up to 3 sigma. Nothing special. But if you look for something new, a nearly 3 sigma signal gets you a little bit excited. Yeah? That's true? Yeah. December 2011, the picture changed with more statistics. Essentially nowhere any fluctuation, everything was flat, except here. There was something, 3.5 sigma, popping up. The probability was 3.5 sigma that it's not a fluctuation. We have seen 3.5 sigma signals coming and going, quite a few. However, the excitement increased. Then, with more analysis, it went down again a bit, but it did not disappear. And that's already the first lesson. Not everything goes always in the same direction. There are also sometimes fluctuations in the direction. And it's very important. If everything goes always in the same direction, you should be very suspicious. So that was a good signal, a good lesson. And then July 2012, nothing anywhere but more than 5 sigma probability that it is not a fluctuation. And at that moment, we could say, we have it. And it was the same in both experiments. And you see, it's such a clean signal, such a very nice evolution. This is a textbook distribution, how such a discovery appears over 1 year. And then at the moment of the publication, it was already 6 sigma, so it was even better, and today it's even more. So this was an exciting year, I can tell you. And there are much worse times to be Director General of CERN than at such a moment. So that was great. Okay, but is the new particle a Higgs boson? Well, the two big experiments have verified the two main fingerprints. First of all, if this guy provides mass to elementary particles, it has to couple, to talk to these particles, it has to couple to these particles depending on the mass of these particles. High mass particles, it has to couple stronger than to low mass particles. And it looks like, within the error bars, everything is okay. So that's fine. And they have verified that the spin of this particle is zero. It is representing a scalar field. So the answer is definitely yes. We have it. It completes the standard model, describing now 5% of the universe. But this is an interesting transparency. No, otherwise, I would not show it. This particle is special. All matter particles, it should be an E. No, that should be off. All matter particles are spin 1/2 fermions. They have a spin. All force particles are bosons, but they have a spin 1. All particles we knew up to then, fundamental particles, have spin. The Higgs is spin 0. It is a scalar. It does not have a spin. It is the only fundamental particle scalar particle ever discovered. It's neither matter nor force, it is just different. No spin. The Brout-Englert Higgs field, of which the Higgs boson is a messenger, is a scalar field, and therefore the Higgs boson has to be a scalar, and it's everywhere in the universe. Dark energy is a scalar everywhere in the universe. So maybe by investigating the Higgs boson, investigating the properties of the Higgs boson, maybe we get some hints on the properties of dark matter, at least on the properties of scalars. And why should the Higgs boson be the only scalar fundamental particle? Why? There's no reason, really. And the LHC, of course, can search for such scalars, and if found, can investigate them. But this is very important. It's the only fundamental scalar. Come on. I was tired when I did this translation. It is a discovery, 2012, and the Nobel Prize in Physics 2013, François-Englert and Peter Higgs. Both independently wrote their papers in 1964. The first time they met was 2012 at CERN. That's great, huh? It's unimaginable, but it's true. Okay, and this is where CERN and all the experimenters at ATLAS CMS and all the people from the LHC and of the other colliders are really deeply inside this Nobel Prize. So, where are we today? Data taking, of course, has finished at energies of 7 and 8 TeV. It took until beginning of 2013. Data analysis is still in full swing. LHC and all other accelerators at CERN in the years 2013-14 were under maintenance and improvement. Now, step by step, the accelerators are switched on again, and on the smaller accelerators, physics is already resuming. But in particular, all high current connections at the LHC were consolidated. All 10,000 high current connectors were maintained and consolidated. And also the experiments have, of course, worked on the maintenance and improvement. So what is tomorrow? The whole thing is only the beginning. Discovery is easy. To study the properties is now the work. That is now a lot of work. Again, data taking will be restarted 2015 at an energy of 13 TeV. So going from 8 to 13, nearly doubling. Later on, we will go to design energy of 14 TeV. We know it is a Higgs boson. But is it the Higgs boson of the Standard Model? Or is it one of several, one of a family? And that needs a lot of study. That can take a long time in order to find out the small differences between a single particle and one of a family. But its properties could give information on dark matter. If there is a deviation of the property of one property from the prediction of the Standard Model, could be an indication of dark matter particles. So that is a very, very important step, and that can take a long time. Its properties could also give first hints, and there I'm much more careful, on dark energy. But it could be the first view into the dark universe, and I think at least my understanding of the universe is about to change. So altogether, we have set up a physics program at the Large Hadron Collider to study all these things beyond 2030, roughly up to 2035. So, the past decades saw precision studies of 5% of our universe. I call it the discovery of the Standard Model. The LHC delivers data, and we have a discovery. We have found this famous Higgs boson. I think we are just at the beginning of exploring 95% of the universe. I would say the future is bright in the dark universe. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your lecture.
Yes. I had changed the font. It's not Cosmic Sense normally, but okay, doesn't matter. I got a question of a journalist today, and I said it's an April joke, and now I have it on my transparency, so okay.
Nevertheless, thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you. I think that on behalf of all participants here, we would like to express our gratitude to very illustrative and very, very powerful lecture how CERN works for the peace in the physical discoveries. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we have few minutes for very few questions. Questions are preferably with respect to the remarks. Please use the microphone if you would like to give some question to Professor Hoyer. Who wish to ask? It is the microphone.
Don't hesitate. I usually get questions. Yeah. If you ever want to become an accelerator scientist at CERN, okay.
So I liked very much your example of X and the journalists. And you show this huge scale of the universe 10 to the 28, 10 to the minus 34. Also, the time of the universe, it was long ago, but long ago there were no journalists. How do you know
there were,
that?
There were
that
no what?
There were no journalists.
There were no
So how do you know that, that what it is now found, well, it is... You understand my question?
Yeah, I understand your question, but we don't need journalists in order to do our science. We need journalists in order to transport our science into the general public. Okay, as a first remark. But, of course, from all the measurements which I showed, for example, of the cosmic microwave background, you can conclude what had happened at that time, what was the size, because you can calculate size into energy into time, so you can transform that from size to time to energy, etc. Taking all this together, we are pretty sure that all this is correct. So we can extrapolate back. Yeah? But the closer you come in reproducing the conditions, the better you can extrapolate back. Yeah, that's also clear. The less, the shorter the lever arm, the better. And 10 to the minus 12 seconds is already pretty close. But we know all this because we can calculate and see the traces in the universe and taking together astrophysics, astroparticle physics, and particle physics results.
Yes, thank you. Maybe another question? Yes, please.
I would like to ask, if you would have to choose between 100 kilometer colliding experiment on LHC or to build ILC lepton linear collider, which one would you choose for the Higgs production?
He is referring to the study of a 100 kilometer circular proton collider, which we have just, which actually I launched the collaboration tomorrow. But we have launched the study in February this year in order to see what we can do after the LHC, okay?
Yes, yes.
Now, the first paper on LHC appeared in 1984, that's now 30 years ago. That means it's now high time to study a possible next machine. And this is why we do the 100 kilometer. But that would be for protons and heavy ions. And then he refers to the linear collider, which would be electron-positron. Electron-positron masses are much smaller than the proton mass, so they produce much more synchrotron radiation. You need a much, much larger circular collider. The largest circular collider is with a radius of infinity, which is a linear collider. Okay? How to choose is a question to the physics. At the moment, in order to study the details of the Higgs boson, you can use the LHC, but you can also use the ILC, which is propagated in Japan. Why both? Because you look at the same questions from a different view angle, and only by combination of the results you get the full picture. So there's a justification to do that. If the LHC finds something in addition to the standard model, something which goes beyond the standard model, then you need higher energies. Then you would possibly go to a future circular collider or to another linear collider with higher energy. But it depends a lot on the results from LHC and on the results from underground experiments and of telescopes. So the study does not only comprise accelerator studies, but also physics. You cannot go to the funding agency and say, oh, we are particle physicists, we want a bigger machine, give us a few billion. That's impossible. You have to give them a physics justification, and that is what you have to study too.
Thank you.
You're satisfied. Well, is another question? Maybe short three more. Maybe last question. Yes, please.
Hi. Speaking of the future of the colliders, and my friend just suggested the idea about linear collider. What I am wondering is that how do you see the development in plasma acceleration taking the position of Large Hadron Colliders today?
Yeah, there are several steps. The circular collider he was referring to, the linear collider, they use technologies which we have to further develop, but which we have, at least to some extent, in our hands, to some extent at least. Plasma or laser-driven acceleration is something which goes even one step further. That means it's not, to my mind, not the next step, but the next but one step. Because it takes a long time to transfer the experience from the tabletop into a large facility. However, we have to do that, and CERN is also engaging now in a WAKE. This is the plasma wake field experiment. I know that here Eli, they try to do something with laser acceleration. In France, they do something. So we are collaborating on these things, especially with the centers in France, to hopefully drive the acceleration, the accelerator gradient further. The higher the gradient, the better, of course. The problem is, and that's a challenge to the young people here, the transfer efficiency from the wall plug power into the beam is still too small. That is a challenge. That is a real challenge, and I think we don't know yet how to solve it. But the higher efficiency of the from the power out of the wall plug into the beam will give you much better chances to produce accelerators of higher energy. That is what something you young guys should work on. Not all of you, but at least some of you.
Thank you. Probably it was the last question. Thank you for the answers. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to mention on the very closing words that was seen and it is no doubt that the research this is doing in particle physics in CERN is really of the highest level of quality. It really is the center of excellence in the particle physics research. But probably you mentioned that it is not the only field that CERN is concerned to, because they are, as they, with the CERN, same enthusiasm, they are concerned to the applications, not only in medicine, but in material research, in another field, solid state physics, and superconducting questions, and so on and so on. And the very important thing is that in all these questions, CERN is working on the highest level of quality. That means it should be expressed like a slogan that the excellence implies excellence. And I think that it should be a slogan for us as well, because it is quite important knowledge that it is necessary to construct the research on the highest level of quality. That means, first of all, it is necessary to support excellence in research. And to make it in another word, it should be a tragic mistake. But nevertheless, thank you very much for your lecture. It really was inspiring and very illustrative for us. I would like to express our gratitude to all of you and to the question that you participate in the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.